Good morning, everybody. Thanks a lot, Pastor Brett and Scott. Those guys sure disappear quickly, don't they? Thanks also for setting this up for me, Adrian. Well, the staff has done a great job of introducing you folks to us already. And if you're watching on stream, if you're watching online, just to let you know, I'm Ralph Peters. My wife's name is Carrie. We're interim here, and we're loving it. I mean, it's been 2 weeks, and you folks have been so gracious. Everywhere we've gone, we've just been received, and thank you. Thank you for receiving us, because for the most of you, we are perfect strangers, but there's something that connects us, isn't it? And it's the love of Jesus, and it's so good to be a part of what you're doing here in this special season for you as a church in the interim. And my thoughts go to Pastor Dave Funk, and I just want to acknowledge him today. He's just a good brother in the Lord. I know his dad better than I know him, but I know that the Lord used him mightily here in Penticton and in Bethel, and you folks miss him a lot. We hear about that all the time. And so I just bless them there in Abbotsford at APA, and know that God's going to use them there in a powerful way. And I also want to say that the church staff here are an exemplary bunch of people. I mean, so gifted and wonderful. And I'm kind of laughing because they're very gifted at practical joking. In fact, you know the my clock wall keeps changing its time all by itself, you know, and just all by itself, confusing me. So I've got it set at 1:00 to 12:00, you know, just to let them know that their time is coming very quickly. But, you know, they can joke in such a fun way that I mean, so innocent about it that I must be a gift. I don't know, but I'll leave it at that. So we're continuing our series on the Psalms of Ascent. And our theme is ascend, and I see it as ascending to be more like Jesus, to be more like our King, our leader. The Psalms, or the Songs of Ascent, as some people refer to them as, are a collection of psalms. They run from Psalm 120 to 135. They're part of the group, the Psalms, the 150 Psalms, for those of you unfamiliar with the books of the Bible. But they're a special group of songs, and they were sung by the pilgrims in the past, most likely as they traveled towards where they were going to worship God. Initially, that wasn't Jerusalem. It was the tabernacle. It was wherever God's presence was, wherever the Ark of the Covenant was. That was the focal point of their worship. But it eventually became Jerusalem on Mount Moriah or Mount Zion. The name keeps shifting the places with the places. But I think you know what I mean. The Temple Mount, Jerusalem, where both temples were built. And these temples were both destroyed over time because of the people's unfaithfulness to the Lord. But the focus was always on the place and worshiping God, because God so inhabited his people. And there were certain places where he just saw his presence was just so real and so powerful. Now the temples have both been destroyed. And the focus of worship for the Jews nowadays is on the Western or Wailing Wall. Some of you folks have been there. It's really the only part that's left of the ancient temples. Moses told the people of God way back in Deuteronomy 16:16 that every Jewish man was required each day, each year, to celebrate the three main festivals. So every man, each festival, three times a year. And the festivals were the Festival of Unleavened Bread, which we also know as Passover, the Festival of Harvest or Pentecost, and the Festival of Shelters, which was Tabernacles. And it's interesting to note that the celebration, the festivals, also had something to do with nature and the cycles of nature as well as their history. Passover, for instance, was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and it was basically a celebration of freedom. God delivered them from Egypt, from their slavery, those 400 years, and it was a celebration of this, and it was instituted by God after he freed them from slavery, after they were on their way to the Promised Land. And it's celebrated in the springtime. And then 7 weeks are counted from Passover to the Feast of Pentecost, which celebrates the revelation of God's blessings. And you know, just the law that came to them. This is how God thinks. This is how God wants us to live. And it was a celebration of even the Ten Commandments. And it marks the beginning of summer. And then there's the Feast of Tabernacles. And it celebrates the fall harvest as well as remembering the tents that they lived in. And that's why it's called the Feast of Tabernacles. They lived in those tents for 40 years. That must have been quite the camping trip. 40 years. It wasn't fun, for sure. But it's also a festival of thanksgiving and gratitude to God for the blessings in life and for the hope of continued blessings. Now, these days, it's mainly Orthodox Jews. It's mainly those who are keeping according to the law within Judaism that these feasts are celebrated in this way. So we've already looked at three of the Psalms of Ascent, and Pastor Adrian and Pastor Kirsten. Kind of left my mind there for a moment. I don't know how that happens, but Pastor Kirsten, they've handled these psalms so well, and now, and they're really messages worth reviewing. If you missed any of these messages on the three psalms that were covered, they're worth reviewing. But now we look at Psalm 133, and that's my psalm today, and the focus is on unity. But before I want to read this psalm, I'd like us to have a clear understanding of what unity is and also what it isn't. And I want to start with what unity isn't. Unity is not agreeing on everything. You don't all have to have the same color to have unity or like the same color. You don't all have to drive the same car or a truck, or a motorcycle, to be unified with someone. You don't all have to live in the same place to be unified with somebody, to be in unity. It's also not incoherence. Unity is not imbalance, and it certainly is not violence. Unity is harmony. Unity, and I love this definition, I found it this week. It's a balanced, pleasing, or suitable arrangement of parts. Now keep this in mind as we read this psalm, okay? Please follow along in your smartphones, your Bibles, or on the screen. I think for those watching, it's on the screen. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is like precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion, for there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore. So imagine with me, a lot of people on pilgrimage. Okay, a lot of people climbing up the roads to Jerusalem. They're walking, they're riding their donkeys or camels or horses or they're in wagons. A lot of people on the road. And then approaching Jerusalem, and then coming through the gates. When David wrote this, there would have been 12 gates to Jerusalem. Now, I say there was a lot of people because history tells us that around the time of Jesus, there were about 30,000 people living in Jerusalem, 30,000 residents. At Passover in Jesus' day, there were about 80,000. 80 to 100,000 people. Say 50,000 people walking down the road into Jerusalem for the three main festivals. Walking, dirty, dusty, approaching. Now, there were all sorts of pools that had been set up and everything along the way for people to get cleaned up and to purify themselves spiritually as well. But nonetheless, all these people, you know, cutting in front of each other and budging in and getting stepping on each other, and all these people walking, and yet, imagine this, yet they're singing, oh, this psalm, how good and pleasant it is when God's people live in unity. It must have been an incredible sight. Can you just imagine it? Such unity. Now, you wonder, how could Jerusalem even handle so many people? Well, they just did. They were ready to receive their brothers and sisters. They slept all over the place in the market areas. They just were embraced by each other. There was unity for them. And then as they walked, they sang this. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. Can you hear them singing that? You say, well, that's great. That's good for them. But what about us for today? What are the implications of this psalm for us today? What I'm asking is what's the important question here for us? What is the big question from this psalm? Actually, what conclusion can we draw from this psalm for us today? How do we apply it to our lives? A couple things about unity that we see right here in this psalm that'll help us with this, okay? So first of all, we see that unity is wonderful. It's wonderful. It's good. It's pleasant. It's precious. Again, what's so precious about somebody taking oil and pouring it over your head and it running down your beard and into your collar? Kind of a gooey mess, wouldn't you say? You know, what's so precious about that? What's so precious about it? Well, anointing with oil is symbolic of God setting a person apart. Setting them apart for something very special. In the Old Testament, they poured a special oil. It was actually a compound of sacred oil and spices. And it was taken pretty seriously. Anointing someone with oil was very serious. When the priests were anointed with oil, that was something very serious. In Exodus 30, you can read how the Lord directed Moses to make this special sacred oil. It's made with olive oil, it's made with other spices. And then anoint and consecrate Aaron and his sons to serve the Lord's priests. What David, actually David wrote this psalm, and what David is writing about is wonderful. It's not something you want to get away from even. It's not something you want to run from. In fact, it's something you want to run to. It's so amazing. It's so beautiful. You want to run to it. Unity is something special. It's something you want. Benson in his commentary writes, oil is, without a question, the finest emblem of union that ever was conceived. It is a substance consisting of very small parts, which yet, by their mutual adhesion, constitute one uniform, well-united, and useful body. And David imagines unity is this sacred oil running down Aaron's head and onto his beard and the collar and his priestly robes. And this picture was very appropriate because the pilgrims coming into Jerusalem would experience this very thing. They would look on their priests and they would imagine, they would see it. They would have a visual of the priest in his stately garments, and on right on the breastplate of the priest were the 12 tribes of Israel listed, their nation, their people. And you know, the pilgrims, I think they could have symbolized the unity of the nation in worship under their consecrated priest. What a picture. But you need to know, this wasn't only a solemn and sacred and really serious time. It was a joyful time as well. It was a time of celebration. It was good and pleasant, and it was wonderful to be there. It was wonderful to be there, all unified together. Something else that'll help us, we see in verse 3, help us to understand this whole unity thing. Unity is refreshing. It brings a blessing. Actually, a blessing follows unity. When God's people live together in unity, it's like dew falling. David writes, unity is as if the dew of Mount Hermon were falling on Mount Zion. And this is a great comparison. In Israel, dew was often a crucial source of water, and the dew of Hermon was heavy, and it was needed to irrigate this arid area of the world. Hermon was a mountain to the north, and the dew was so heavy it brought amazing refreshing and invigoration. The refreshing influence of the people of God and community on the nation. It was similar to the dew falling on the vegetation, bringing water. I love dew. It's one of the reasons why fall is my favorite season. In the last couple of weeks, the dew has been falling kind of heavy where we live in OK Falls, and I'm so thankful for it because I don't have to haul around the hoses and the sprinklers, and it's natural irrigation coming from heaven, and some of you cannot relate to me because you've got underground sprinkler systems and stuff like that. But if you're like me, you're probably thinking, yeah, this is a great time of the season when you don't have to haul that water around. Dew. I love its freshness, and it's so good for the vegetation, and my wife loves it on her flowers, and it's just refreshing. I'll tell you something, people of God. When we're unified, it's an absolutely wonderful thing because it brings great refreshing everywhere we go. It brings great blessings. Isn't that what it says? Unity brings great blessing, even life forevermore. Let me illustrate how this works by telling you a bit about the greatest missions movement the world has ever known. Some of you will recognize this right away. So the year is 1722, young people. You got that? You probably can't even imagine 1722. Well, they looked a lot like you did back then. You know, things just keep coming around, styles and all. But 1722, okay? So this is more than 200 years after Luther nailed his 95 thesis to the church in Wittenberg, okay? So it's 200 years after the Protestant Reformation. So a people group known as the Moravians, who followed a man by the name of John Huss, who lived quite a few years before that, probably about 300 years before that, who was a forerunner of the Reformation. He preached Jesus. And so this group, they followed his teachings and were terribly persecuted as a result because of the Counter-Reformation movement that was happening at the time, still going on. And so it got so bad for them to the point where they had to flee their country, which was Bohemia, modern-day Czech Republic. But they were part of the Bohemian kingdom at that time. So they're trying to find a place where they can have refuge. So they hear about Count Zinzendorf. He's a pietist. He's a godly man. He has property just north of them in Saxony, Germany. So one day, Count Zinzendorf answers his door, and here's this motley group of people, Moravians, who had been fleeing, seeking refuge, and he gives them refuge. And word gets back to the Moravians in Czech Republic, and they begin to come by the dozens to him. And he gives them a chunk of his land on which they built their own town. They called it Herrnhut, the blessing of the Lord. And Zinzendorf just gave it to them, and he was criticized by his contemporaries for doing that. But he showed them this love and compassion. But it took only about 4 years for the disunity and the dysfunction of this group, of these Moravians, to show. And it showed up, and when it showed up, it was bad. It was bad. And Zinzendorf confronted them. He said, this is bad, and there's underlying stuff that needs to be dealt with. And he basically forced them to come together for prayer meetings, and they prayed regularly. And then one day, and the date is May the 12th, 1727, revival came. It was at a communion service. Zinzendorf even forced them to have communion together, and something dramatic and powerful took place, a transformation. And the reports I read, even as early as this week, just some of what was said was, here's, they were filled with new life and power. Dissension disappeared, and unbelievers were converted. They referred to this day as their Pentecost, the powerful presence of Jesus that filled the place. And Zinzendorf himself wrote, the whole place represented truly a visible habitation of God among men. And then a little over a month later, 24 men and 24 women covenanted to spend 1 hour each day in scheduled prayer. And then others started signing up, and everybody wanted to be involved in this hourly intercession, is what they called it. And a brotherly agreement was formulated, and the 24/7 prayer meeting started, and it went for 10 years? No. 50? Double that amount. It went for 103 years. 103-year, 24/7 prayer meeting. We never hear about it. Changed our world. And the Moravians called that summer the golden summer of 1727. I love it. And they became known as Unity of the Brethren. Well, here's where it gets really good, okay? 6 months after the beginning of the prayer watch, Zinzendorf got it in his mind that it's time we did mission. So he approached them one day, and he said, we need to take the gospel to the nations. We need to take the gospel to West Indies, Greenland, Turkey, and northern parts of Scandinavia, northwestern Russia, down the coast of Africa. We need to go. We need to take the gospel. We need to take the gospel message. And they were skeptical and resisted. But Zinzendorf, history tells us, stood there and he persisted. And the next day, 26 Moravians stepped forward to volunteer for world missions. Wherever the Lord would lead them, they would go. And these missionaries were fearless. And you've got to know that when these missionaries left, They were so convinced that they were giving their lives for the mission that they packed their stuff in a coffin rather than in suitcases and in crates, because they knew that they were going to give their lives. Why bother with suitcases, and why bother with crates? We're going to give our lives anyways. Why not just skip a few steps and build the coffin and here we go? They said God was calling them to the nations to preach the gospel. What happened because they got unified? 65 years later, in 1791, after the start of the 24/7 prayer meeting, this small group of Moravian people, about 300 people, when they started, sent out 300 missionaries around the world. I wanted to show you an animated map today, a map from Map of Wars. It's actually on the history of religion. But I didn't want to take so much time. But it shows how the world religion started and where they were all growing and how Christianity grew after Jesus and how Islam got on the scene and Muhammad, you know, and all what was going on in North Africa and Southeast Asia. And then along comes 1727, missions abroad. And it's like the major part of the world turns the color that's been designated for Christianity. Now, the world contributes the expansion of Christianity to the age of discovery. But missions to the world, coastal regions, started by the Moravians, this is when it took place. It's been said by missiologists that the Moravians are the pioneers of modern-day missions. For sure, coastal missions, because everywhere they went, they were like a beachhead. They set it up, and all the inland missions followed after that, African inland, China inland. I don't think this gets the attention that it really deserves. Unity brings unreal mission results. It brings life forevermore to people, exactly like what Psalm 133 says. So is living in unity a basic component in taking the gospel to the world? I would give it an unqualified yes. Absolutely. Carrie and I have been to Herrenhut several times, and to where the prayer movement began. We've climbed a prayer tower. We've stood dumbfounded as we've looked over thousands of grave markers representing the thousands who died for the cause of world mission. They call it God's acre. Actually, there are other God's acres around the world. They gave their lives for the mission of God for Messiah Day. The church exists for mission. And people coming to know Jesus is the fruit of walking in unity. There's no way to get around it. Let me bring it all home now. We're living in a very divisive time here in our little corner of the world. There's some major things dividing our families, our communities, and our nation. We're in a pandemic, and we're about to have a national election. You know, I want to thank God for Bethel, for the unity there is here. Since being here, I've just sensed such a sweet spirit, and praying with you is wonderful. Praying with the men Wednesday morning is just wonderful. I'm looking forward to Thursday again. It's just such a sense of unity and praying together. It's wonderful. But sad to say, this isn't the norm for the church in North America. It's not the norm for the church the Okanagan. There are some very high-profile people expressing their opinions and expressing their opinions as truth. And it's dividing us as a church of Jesus, and it's dividing families. I started my message today with the definition of unity. Unity is a balanced, pleasing, or suitable arrangement of parts. And then I asked, what conclusion can we draw from this psalm for us today? And how can we apply it to our lives? Aaron was the earthly high priest, but Jesus is our heavenly high priest, Hebrews tells us. Oil represents the presence and power of the Spirit of God all through the Bible. And we as followers of Jesus have been anointed to serve as priests. Peter writes about it. 1 Peter 2:9, he declares that we are a royal priesthood. In 2 Corinthians 1, verses 21 to 22, affirms that God has anointed us. He's placed his Spirit in our hearts. 1 John 2, 2-7, I wish I could go to all of these passages of Scripture. But here John refers to this anointing as an event with ongoing results. The Spirit on us. The anointing with this Holy Spirit on us is a royal priesthood, our high harmonizing together. It's a sweet unity. In Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, the first four chapters, he deals with the factions that there are, the divisions in the church in Corinth, and the fruit of divisions. And just before Paul deals with this in the next four chapters, he makes a statement right after he exposes all of the factions. And just before he begins to deal with them, he says, some were saying, well, I'm a follower of Paul, and others Apollos. And then some were saying, I'm a follower of Peter. And probably the most self-righteous groups, well, we're followers of Christ. You guys have it all wrong, all of you. And he says, was I, Paul, crucified for you? Were any of you baptized in the name of Paul? Verse 17, for Christ didn't send me to baptize, but to preach the good news. I wasn't calling people to myself, and not with clever speech. And why did he say this? Listen to this line out of verse 17. For fear that the cross of Christ would lose its power. For fear that the cross of Christ would lose its power. There it is. Division causes the cross of Christ to lose its power. Now, I'm not speaking about differences of opinion. As I said, there are so many differing opinions these days. There's theological, political, geopolitical, medical, movies, food, and on and on and on it goes. Different opinions. Can't we be unified despite differing opinions? What if we could? I mean, what if we really could? What would happen? What would happen if we were a balanced, pleasing, and suitable arrangement of parts as the church, the big C, the church of Jesus Christ? Oil represents the unity of the Spirit that only He can bring among such a diverse group of God's people that we call the church. Unity is like the oil of the Holy Spirit flowing on all of us so we can be a blessing to the nations like dew. What does the world need from us? What does the world need from us as followers of Jesus, from the church? More than anything else, what does it need? I believe it's a display of love towards each other that will result in love to the world. That's what the world needs from the church. Let's bow our heads. Just wondering if there could be someone watching right now. And right now in their heart, there's a lot of anger and frustration, maybe even hatred towards people who aren't in agreement with them. If that's you, the oil of the Holy Spirit wants to come over you, wants to wash over you. And if you're in this room, and you're feeling that, let the Spirit Let the Spirit come over you, wash over you like dew. Maybe you're listening or you're here and you're here on this long weekend and visiting, or you've just stumbled onto the church here, or you've been coming for a while, and Jesus is not the leader. He's not the forgiver of your life. Well, you could make him that today. I pray you do. Just simply by saying, come into my life, Lord Jesus. Forgive me. I want to be your child. You can do it. Lord, I pray for these people. Pray for us as the people of God. I pray that we guard the unity that we know and love here at the church. I pray also, Lord, we pray for our brothers and sisters who don't know this and who need to know it. Call us to prayer for them, Lord. Call us to protecting the unity of the body of Jesus Christ. Call us to that, Lord, we pray. Thank you, O God. Thank you. Thank you, O God.
Hey, we appreciate that you decided to join us for church this morning. We hope you had a chance to connect with Jesus or learn something new. If you are new here in the past couple weeks, thanks for coming. You know, if you haven't come to one of our in-person services, we would love it if you came out. We have a service at 9 a.m. and one at 11. No need to register, just show up on Sunday morning. As well, if you haven't filled out a New Here card, we encourage you to do that by going to betheltab.ca/imnew. We can't wait to connect with you. As well, here at Bethel Church, we believe in the power of prayer and the change it can have in our lives. If you or someone you know is in need of prayer, then we encourage you to go to betheltab.ca/prayer and fill out a prayer request form so that we can be praying for you. Thank you for joining us this morning. We hope that you leave feeling challenged and encouraged. Have a great day.